Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, in truth and love. Amen. The basis for the sermon this morning is from our text from Hebrews, in which Jesus is our high priest. You may be seated. There is a certain similarity between pastors now and priests in the Old Testament. There is a certain similarity. They die. They move on. Perhaps go to another congregation. Their office is not always filled. And you always need another person to fill it. And that there is a certain similarity. Though the Old Testament priests were given to sacrifice, our pastors are not given to sacrifice, the priests came only from one family. Our pastors do not come from just one family, one descendant. Yet there is this similarity, this finality that they will end, that there are gaps. And this goes certainly all the way back to the instructions given for the priests. Not only were they given to sacrifice daily for specific sins, but they set up a day. But was set up for them a day, the Day of Atonement, where once a year, on this only one day of the year, the high priest, only the high priest, would go into the Holy of Holies, the center of the temple where the Ark of the Covenant was, where God's presence sat. But he couldn't just go in there because it was a special day. He was unclean. He was sinful. Before this, he must wash himself. He must get the special linens, the special pure white clothing, wrap himself in them, make a sacrifice for his sins specifically, and then, only then, may the one special chosen high priest enter in. God did provide a way for it to happen. He gave these instructions. It is by his power that he was holy enough to enter. Not the man's, not from everything that he did. But God provided a way. And it worked. Aaron, as the first high priest, brother of Moses. But it, you know, as we do, he died. And so his son came after him and did the same. And so along on down the genealogy. But Christ, as we hear from Hebrews, has the priesthood permanently. No gaps, no imperfections. He was perfectly innocent, unstained. There's no need to make sacrifice for his sins. He can go straight into God's presence. There is this perfect sacrifice on behalf of the people, himself, as he himself is without blemish. He is more pure than even the lamb upon the altar. And furthermore, he constantly pleads for us. The high priest would go once a year, maybe, or once a day sacrificing, but Christ pleads eternally. And so Christ has supplanted this priesthood and fulfilled it grandly, greatly, and eternally. And we know this. We have it here. But what to do on Sunday morning? I mean, we have ourselves an image of Christ up here. But we cannot sit here and watch him plead for us. That'd make for a boring sermon. We can't just come around no one. So Christ has instituted this special office of pastor. It's not the same as the priesthood, for in baptism we all share in the priesthood. To be a priest meant that you could go before God. We all may go before God and plead with him and pray. We all may ask for our forgiveness and it be given. We all may forgive our brother and know that he is forgiven. We all are priests, in the Old Testament sense. We all have the right, just like in the same way, to eat of the sacrifice, to eat the body and blood of Christ. So no, this man, the pastor, is not simply a priest. See, the pastor shares more fully in this with Christ. We have this priesthood, we have union with Christ as an individual Christian in baptism, baptized into his death, into his resurrection, and into his priesthood, surely. But the pastor has a specific relationship with Christ. We see this as Christ commands it in John chapter 20. Just as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you, he says to the apostles. And the apostles hand this ministry, this office down to the church as a whole. And so the church raises up pastors. Just as Christ was sent by the Father. See, Christ was one with God. And he was one with humanity. He was man and God. That is how God sent him. He was sent to give forgiveness. He was sent to die. He was sent to give the Holy Spirit. He was sent to begin and institute the sacraments. And he was sent to be a servant of all. The pastor, if you think of when we have confession and absolution as during the order of Holy Communion or of the Declaration of Grace with morning service, the pastor stands right there and he begins facing the congregation and he turns to face the altar and he turns to face the congregation and he turns to face the altar. He goes back and forth, depending on who he is representing, who he is advocating for, who he is speaking on behalf of. See, when he is facing the congregation, he is speaking as one with God, just as Christ was one with God. And when he faces the altar, he is one with the people, with the church, just as Christ was one with the people. He pleads on your behalf, in the same way that Christ pleads on your behalf, though it be for a time, certainly on Sunday mornings, but also as he would pray throughout the week on behalf of his congregation, at least daily, if not more. He is here in that absolution to give forgiveness, as Christ gives forgiveness. He's here to give the Spirit, in the preaching of the word, in baptism, just as Christ came to bestow his Holy Spirit. He was given to speak the words of the Father and to do his will, just as Christ was given to. And in the same way, he was given to be both a leader, the ruler, but also, more importantly, the servant of all, which never stands below his leadership. So you have this comfort that not only is Christ in heaven pleading before the Father at his throne, saying, "Lord, forgive them. Accept my sacrifice. It was pure, it was holy, it was perfect. It was according to your will. Please forgive them." But you have a man. You shall have a man right here to do that, that you may see, that may be there as Christ pleading on your behalf. It's not just something that happens in the mind, something that happens in heaven when we cannot see it, but we can experience it. It is real and true as it happens right here. There is no denying. This office of pastor is a sure blessing for his church. A sure blessing of Christ in the midst of his people. These are the jobs, this is the job that is given by God specifically for the pastor through Christ. It is the divinely given task that he is appointed with. Sure, he may do other tasks in the church, in the congregation. There are other things he will do. But this is what defines it. All else is from human authority, and it may be right and so and what should happen. But no matter who is in this office, this happens. There's no denying it. Whomever you call, whomever accepts, whoever God places here through you is there in place of Christ. He is Christ standing before you, and is Christ there to forgive you all of your sins. It is the same act as Jesus doing it before his Father in heaven. And so you may know that not only do you have forgiveness, but you have it constantly. Because it is constantly pleaded for you. Christ has been exalted above the heavens so that he may stand at the feet of his Father for you. In the name of Jesus, amen. Please rise. May the peace which passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus from now into eternity. Amen.